Good day. My name is Mary Byrne, and on behalf of the Victoria Symphony, I welcome you to my music studio to have a little chat about Claude Debussy and his 1894 orchestral masterpiece, Prélude à l'après-midi d'un fond. I'm a flutist, and this music both enchants me and terrifies me. The ask on the flutist by this opening solo places it right near the top of our most formidable solos list. For one thing, the breath length certainly exceeds comfortable and may even exceed possible. On top of that, the sensuous smoothness that Debussy requires out of this piece requires a confidence of blowing technique and finger technique that will hold up under the nervous pressures of this opening solo. And then for me, the solo has this dual personality. On the one hand, it's wildly passionate, but on the other hand, it's deeply introspective. And that's a very fine line to walk. And then this all on top of the fact that it does come out of utter silence at the opening of the work and then sort of nudges the story into existence. This is a test that every principal flutist everywhere, and I think I'm safe in saying that, will have had to have passed in order to get the chair. And I think that most everyone is going to have some sort of story that talks about how it either went horribly wrong or spectacularly well. However, put that aside. Very few pieces of music cause me to stop and sit and listen and want so badly to be completely enveloped in the music, as does this piece by Debussy. Yes, as a flutist, I am humbled by it. And as a musicologist, sometimes I'm perplexed, but it's almost always a fascinating journey through this daring and seemingly effortless musical world that flows right off of the end of Debussy's pen. But for me, it's really as a listener where the music gets me. I am overwhelmed by the sheer beauty of this music, the intoxicating nature of this music, and not just the first time I heard it, every time I come back to it. And so, with your permission, I'd like to dig in and see if we can't uncover some of the mysteries of this music. Claude Debussy was still relatively unknown to the public at large when at the age of 32, his Prélude à l'après-midi d'un fond was premiered at a concert by the Société Nationale de Musique on the 22nd of December in 1894. By this time, he was already respected by music connoisseurs, but hadn't yet made a mark in the concert hall. This premiere would change everything. It's hard to pin down who Debussy actually was as a person. His biographer, François Lézieux, uses words like withdrawn, unsociable, taciturn, distant, and shy. He came from a hard life background of very workaday parentage. His first piano lessons were enabled by connections his father made while in prison following his participation in the 1871 Paris Commune. The connections were good, however, and the lessons enabled the talented lad to gain admission to the Paris Conservatoire. Debussy's time at the Conservatoire is the stuff of legends. Essentially, he questions everything and rejects everything. He hurls accusations of mustiness against the Conservatoire, and in doing that, he does not mean a negligent cleaning staff. He is hurling those accusations at his professors. Now, in my experience, students who are inclined to challenge long-held beliefs, they're not doing that to be rabble-rousers. They are genuinely trying to get to know what the thought process is behind the rules. And so any answer that comes too close to, well, that's just the way we do it, that's when you get the backlash. And that seems to be exactly the kind of answer that Debussy was getting from his professors. Don't try something new. It's not the way we do it. And so Debussy essentially turns his back on the institution and goes his own way. Underlying Debussy's challenge to the accepted authority of Beaux-Arts music establishment here in the late 19th century was a very valid observation on his part that by this time, writers and visual artists had already gone a very different direction, moving away from the very descriptive ideas of high romanticism and towards a no less romantic but more vague and suggestive style of imagery. And so I think this was Debussy's call to his fellow musicians of, hey, why aren't we doing exactly the same thing? In fairness, musicians are often late to the party. It is not uncommon to observe the onset of style changes in music quite a ways after those changes have already taken place in parallel forms of art or literature. And sometimes we can measure that gap in terms of decades or even half centuries. So we're not really the most progressive lot, we musicians. Still, here in 1894, Debussy's Prelude à l'après-midi d'un vent, it is cutting edge. And so we need to lift up the corner of the carpet and peer under and see what some of this pioneering work he was doing actually looks like in action. In order to do that, we would do well to consider the poem by Stéphane Mallarmé that prompted Debussy's music. The story that Mallarmé writes is a new interpretation of the Roman myth of the faun, half man, half goat. Our most famous faun was the Greek demigod Pan. Whether specifically Pan or more generally the faun, this creature has unhealthy appetites regarding women and a pattern of behavior that would have him headlining today's Me Too movement. His iconic attribute, the pan flute, was acquired through a cruel act of possession and domination. It's actually a very icky story, but it's what we've been given to work with. Mallarmé's first interpretation of the faun story was his 1865 monologue of a faun. He had wanted it performed on stage, but it was rejected by the Comédie Française. He tried again in 1875 with improvisation of a faun, but it too was rejected, this time by the Society of Parnassian Symbolist Poets. Finally, in 1876, he managed to publish the work as Eclogue, The Afternoon of a Faun, with ink drawings by Edouard Manet. Early on, the poem was designated as impenetrable. And I freely admit that I find even good English translations of the work to be similarly impenetrable. In all likelihood, Debussy came into contact with this poem either through his own habit of voraciously reading contemporary literature or through his regular attendance at Mallarmé's Tuesday evening salons. For his part, Debussy felt that this poetry was where the words themselves made music. And in 1890, he suggested to Mallarmé that he, Debussy, would write music on this poem. At which point Mallarmé apparently quipped back, "I thought I had done that already." Nonetheless, in 1890 and 1891, we see the pair of them working together towards a staged pantomime version of Mallarmé's poem with music by Debussy. Now, alas, that production never did happen, and so the project was set aside again. But a year later in 1892, Debussy takes it back out, and this time begins to contemplate a full orchestral rendering of the poem, which he had planned to be prelude, interludes, and paraphrase finale on The Afternoon of a Faun. And it's from this grand conception that we get our glorious prelude. It's fun to read the words of Gustave Doré, who conducted the first performance of Debussy's work. He used words like seduced, entranced, and overwhelmed to describe the experience of hearing Debussy play his prelude on the piano. As rehearsals proceed, Debussy keeps tweaking the sonorities, but Doré says it was a completely collaborative approach with the orchestra. For his part, however, Doré worried that the performers might not understand this ambitious new work, and he pleaded with them, "Do your best."
Debussy, however, was pleased, and he took the opportunity to pen a note to Mallarmé the day before the premiere and invite him to attend. He did. And in the end, he was very gracious, declaring that he was not expecting anything like that. Ultimately, it was a marvel and offered no dissonance with the poem, except that it went further. Doré must have been nearly breathless as the performance started, but not so the 18-year-old principal flutist Georges Barrère. Doré said that as Barrère started to play the now famous opening solo, "All at once I felt behind me, as some conductors can, an audience that was totally spellbound."
Debussy achieves a perfect balance of ambiguity in this music. To my ear, there is not one sour sound anywhere in it. These beautiful sonorities, however, are lacking just enough specificity that neither do we get gratuitous resting places, nor does the music feel like it pressures itself forward. And so, to see how this works, and before we listen to some of it together, indulge me for a moment. I want to pick apart this opening flute solo.
Debussy writes his music with a key signature of four sharps. What this suggests is that one of two chords should present as the primary building block of the music, either E major or C sharp minor. But Debussy just isn't that straightforward. The flute solo actually blends a bit of both keys, suggesting at the opening a harmony of C sharp minor, and peaking at its top, close to E major. Now, if it were really as simple as a blending, and we can force the analysis to demonstrate this, we'd have this lovely sonority. But it isn't that simple, because the G sharp appears as a G natural as the flute scoops the bottom of the solo. Right here. And for theoreticians out there, that does one of several things. It introduces a tritone to the C sharp, which ultimately suggests a diminished chord. Or it alters the otherwise E major temporarily to E minor, or it creates this not unpleasing polychordal sonority. These wonderful layers together, each one sounding beautiful on its own, is precisely the ambiguity that I mentioned earlier. Now, as if that weren't enough, however, the flute solo actually alights on a chord that has nothing to do with C sharp minor or E major. It's not completely unrelated. It isn't this triad pattern of E major, or even of C sharp minor, but a triad pattern that involves an A sharp. At which point this chord is quickly followed by another chord that's closely related to that. Just a tiny waving of the interior pitches. And it actually leaves us with this large-scale, potent, and uncertain diminished chord right as the flute finishes the solo, which pulls all these big markers together. And then, silence. At this point, the piece is barely 15 seconds old. Let's hear how it unfolds.
Thank you.
And you notice that lovely slithering of the opening solo from high to low and back up. Just like a panpipe would do. And Debussy's smart. The range of his solo from top to bottom and back up, this perfectly outlines the tetrachords of antiquity. And so it's a really thoughtful and insightful gesture to nod towards the Roman inspiration of the work. The piece is packed with details. Option one, you find all the details and follow them all the way through. Option two, you just surrender to this music. Or I suppose as the third option, you could do both. There is some suggestion that all three of the parts Debussy had originally forecast for this poem, the prelude, interludes, and paraphrase finale, all make it into this single piece. And in fact, after this rather extensive preluding section that's led by the flute, there does come what seems like a series of interludes. For a while, the oboe takes over, the clarinet, the horn, and they all contribute to this small succession of little scenes that stay in the spirit of this opening, but then can conduct us through this broader pastoral landscape. So the strings aren't absent, but for a long time Debussy holds them off and really uses them more as a textural element to help sharpen and focus the tone color of the woodwinds in their more pastoral presentation. But when he does bring the strings in, it's late in the music and they just swell up from the bottom and really inflate this whole orchestra until we get this magnificent sort of ecstatic rapture that for me is the most overwhelming part of the whole piece.
Thank you.
of these interludes?
Perhaps. Once we've ridden the wave of this euphoric exaltation, the music does calm down and it does return back to the beginning, and we could fairly call that a paraphrase finale. In the end, the flute does get the final word. We do get snippets of the various interlude bits. They flicker in the air. But it is the flute that gets the final word, even though still pretty much as ambiguous as it was at the opening. And what of the actual story of Mallarmé's poem? As a symbolist poet, I do think narrative was subservient to sonic sensation, and that what is created in the mind is more important than what is expressed on the page. To these ends, I think that Debussy hits the mark spot on. Mallarmé's poem refuses to firmly address the question, does the scene happen? Or is it dreamt? Or is it created in the imagination? As much as I love Nijinsky's 1912 Ballet Russe production and choreography of the music, I wonder about the wisdom of placing specific images to the music. Debussy was certainly not willing to alter one note of the music to suit the choreographic scenario. And so I think in the end, Debussy was just as willing as Mallarmé to leave the question unanswered.
In this music, with this music, worlds are colliding. Tradition is fracturing. I'm not going to say shattering, but certainly cracking, fracturing. Later on, the composer and conductor Pierre Boulez is going to make the proposition that modern music rode in on the back of Debussy's faun. And Leonard Bernstein, about the same time, is going to pick up that very same theme when he considers this piece as part of his Harvard lectures. And I think when we're dealing with two greats of 20th century music, like Boulez and Bernstein, we have to take very seriously what they say. Debussy's music, this particular piece, is inspiration for the next generation. In fact, when we listen to Bernstein lecture about the piece from the piano, you can hear how many of Debussy's sonorities make it into Bernstein's music. But even so, for me, I don't think that this piece is so much about the past or the future as it is about the absolute present. Where are you, the listener, at this moment of time? I think Debussy would wish that you are absolutely immersed in what you are hearing at this exact moment. And that's the underlying impetus behind his ambiguity, to release us from the pressures of time. So, perhaps take a moment to pull it off your shelf, search it online, and for sure, plan to be in the concert hall with us when we do this later this season. Until we get together again, as always, stay safe, stay musical, and have a great day.